How does Uber manages 2,200 microservices using domain-oriented, service-oriented architecture? 2,200 microservices using domain-oriented microservices architecture. Hello friends, today we'll discuss how Uber is managing 2,200 microservices. Lately, microservices have come under a lot of criticism. In a previous video, we saw how a company segment, they went from monolith to microservices, and when they saw a lot of operational problems as their microservices number grew to unmanageable level, they went back to monolith. So Uber came up this document where they show how they are managing 2,200 microservices, and so Uber has gone through a tremendous growth. They used to have couple of dozen programmers, then they went to 100, and now they have gone to thousands. So as they were growing, they could see the monolith applications had serious problems. Deploying monolith application meant you have to work with a lot of people. There were too many risks. You had to bring down whole system. So your system was unavailable for some time. As Uber grew so huge, it was unacceptable. And now Uber staff grew to 1,000 levels, it's difficult for people to work on, so many people work on same application. So dividing the application was very, very difficult. So microservices architecture came handy. The benefit of microservices architecture were you don't have to deploy whole system. You only the microservices which are going through the change, you can upgrade those services so that the downtime is less, there are less risk. And as we saw, like monolith application is very risky and expensive. You have to deploy the whole system, so you have to make sure all the people are available, all the programmers are available. And monolith application had poor separation of concerns. Everything was in the big application. If you're changing one thing, you may be changing a business logic, one part of the business logic, or some data access upgrade. So you have to upgrade the whole system. So we can see it was inefficient execution. So here microservices architecture came handy. Microservices architecture grew out of service-oriented architecture. In service-oriented architecture, you build big monolith services. I think the biggest important point to remember is microservice is about building a service around a specific functionality. It's about functionality. So we can see by using microservices, your system availability became bigger. There was good separation of concerns. If your credit card application is getting upgraded, you don't have to update the inventory microservice or order microservices. And every team owns his own microservices. There is a clean ownership. There's less chance of finger pointing. And we can see that developer velocity increased. But as you go into the microservices architecture, you need a strong DevOps team. DevOps is like having a operation people who can deploy microservices automatically, monitor it. So you need very good staff members to have that kind of architecture. You need very good developers, very good staff. And so Uber started seeing problems with the microservices architecture. So suppose if you had to build some functionality and it has to you develop some 12, you have to deal with 12 teams who are managing microservices. So it can become a very full of hassles. You have to coordinate with 12 teams, talk to their leads, and you are spending a lot of time coordinating with other teams. So they came. So Uber came up domain oriented microservices architecture. It is based on domain driven design. In domain driven design, you have one language. You make sure you focus on the domain, and it is also based on clean architecture. Clean architecture is making sure your business layer is clean. It doesn't have infrastructure concerns in the layers, and also service-oriented architecture. So I have some links. I have playlist for domain-driven design, clean architecture. I'll put in the link down. If you are new to these concepts, check those out. So what are the domains? So as we discussed, there was a problem that you could be dealing with 12 microservices and different teams. So Uber came a good way of coming with domain concept. In domain, you have a lot of services clubbed together. So in this case, like all those 10 services would be in same domain. So you don't have to deal with different teams, different people, and this one. So Uber has defined three domains. In three domains, they have 80 microservices and three gateways. And second thing is they came up with a link. So they have basically five layers that defines how you can one microservices can use another microservices. So first layer is infrastructure layer. Infrastructure layer is more related to engineering tasks. There are microservices related to storage, networking. Then comes the business layer. Business layer microservices deals with the business specific aspect of the business, requesting a ride. Product layer is about product specific feature, requesting a ride kind of thing. Then we have presentation layer. Presentation layer is the about microservices deal with interacting with end consumers. So somebody may be using mobile app to request a ride. And finally, we have edge layer. Edge layer is about interacting with outside vendors, third-party consumers. So all microservices which are working with third-party vendors, they go into the edge layer. Another way they came off is a microservices gateway. Microservices gateway is very popular concept. It's one of the most asked question in the during interviews. So what is microservices gateway? We can think of it as a facade pattern kind of thing, where you're hiding. There will be multiple microservices. When you place an order, there must be multiple microservices behind the scene working. There could be ETL functionality, there could be a order microservice, there could be whether driver is available microservices, there might be credit card microservice. So all these microservices are working. So the point of contact could be a single one, or get me an order that through the gateway. And gateway is hiding, encapsulating all these services inside this gateway. So this gateway is a very great concept. So this makes sure that a lot of time when you make services change to microservices, you have to make upstream changes to the microservices. So gateway hides that complexity. If you are making some changes within the gateway, all other services which are dependent on this gateway are not get affected. So it is hiding from this gateway is hiding these changes from the other one. And also Uber team has given extension points to these domains. They have given logic extensions, data extension. So using logic extension, you can add some functionality using interfaces. So that way you don't have to build everything from the scratch. You can add some custom logic or provide custom data to the system through these extensions to monitor your microservices. Maybe the microservice architecture is not cost effective. But if you are mid-sized, when Uber was startup, they stayed with monolith architecture. As they started growing up, getting into hundreds, that's the time you need to start thinking of some microservices. You have to think about when your code base is growing too much and it will be difficult to divide the functionality among multiple teams. That's the time to start thinking about mid-size. And large size, like Uber, they have seen, they need microservices to manage the huge volume of the business, huge volume of the changes, to keep in pace with their growth. So if you like this video, like it, share it, and subscribe to this channel for your regular updates. Also connect with me on LinkedIn and Twitter, especially LinkedIn, if you like the small summaries of the video. I will be putting a lot of small summaries of the video on Facebook, on LinkedIn. Thanks again. Thank you very much.